So I've been in the e-commerce market for about a year now. I've been watching it, and we finally were launching our product at the same time, which we have come out with about 21 odd days back. So we're just new entrants in the e-commerce field, but I've been watching it for a long time, reading about the trends for a long time. I've got a lot of interest in this. So basically, what I want to talk to you guys about is the new trends in e-commerce and where the market is really going. So accordingly, to start with a few very basic points, the e-commerce market in India is booming. We all know this. People are getting funding left, right, and center. It's really good right now. But it doesn't change the fact that the market has been largely overhyped for the last few years. There's a huge bubble in e-commerce, and basically because the market does not justify the number of entrants into it who are trying to make money. It simply does not. So just to throw out a few numbers, today, I think in 2011, there were about, what is it, 6.4 billion was the e-commerce market in India. And that's a really nice number. In 2012, it's expected to go to something like 13.4 billion, so almost double. That's again a great number, but it doesn't change the fact that this thing is sort of petering out because of very large infrastructure problems within India themselves. Number one being that only about 10% of people have internet access in India. That's growing very fast, but it doesn't change the fact that it's still 10%. It's a very small base, although there are still 120 million people. Second issue is the lack of credit in India. The amount of credit cards in India completely are about 18 million. That's actually less than 1% of the Indian population has a credit card, which is why all these great unique things have come up like cash on delivery, etc. And they're great in many ways because they've got a lot of people into e-commerce. They're buying, anyone with a computer with internet access is buying, and that's great. Except for the fact that cash on delivery is severely harmful to e-commerce businesses in India. It really does not make money. More companies end up making massive losses because of COD rather than profits. Although you're getting more and more people into the field. So to give you a few examples, so I've actually compiled a. So anyways, I'll just explain to you the few first problems that COD, etc. are creating. COD, the major problem being faced is that suddenly you're working capital negative. Okay, because you're not getting the money and then shipping product, now you're shipping the product and then getting the money. About 7 to 8% of people refuse delivery of products in COD, which is a pathetic really number. You can't do anything about it if 7% people refuse delivery. They will give it back to you and say, take it back. You have to. There's no other choice. The simple point is COD is actually very harmful and you're working capital negative. People like Flipkart have pioneered it to get more of the mainstream audience into the e-commerce market and buying, and that's great. But again, it's creating a lot of headaches for the smaller players. So the second thing I'd like to talk about is a bit of consolidation in the e-commerce market. People have been predicting for the last couple of years that e-commerce will now start to consolidate rather than the fragmented model it is today. Today, for example, how many guys sell books or electronics online? Now, I'm sure you guys are all familiar with the big guys like Flipkart, Jabong, etc., who sell books and electronics. But how many people are totally selling it? Probably more than 70 or 80. Those numbers are unsustainable. It just doesn't make sense. Because at 70 to 80 people, the top 3, 4, 5, 6 guys are going to make money, the remaining guys cannot. It just does not make sense anymore. So consolidation in the e-commerce market is leading to the fact that a lot of people have gone in because it seemed like quick VC money, it seemed like a great place to be, you'll make a lot of money really quick. And now people are realizing the real problems that you're facing. Funding has actually gone down in India in the last couple of years, and it is predicted to go down for the next few years as well. Not a lot of people are raising $10 and $20 million rounds anymore. And the second issue is that because of this extreme fragmentation of the market, it is going to start to consolidate in the next few years. Few guys are going to start buying. Flipkart bought Let's Buy last year, though that wasn't only for business purposes. But in the next few years, many people, the smaller competitors, are either going to go bankrupt or they're going to be bought out by the big guys. Because again, smaller models are unsustainable. You have to be either huge or non-existent. So a few other things. Okay. So how do you really solve this problem and find a niche for yourself? Well, the answer isn't that. You find a niche for yourself. Mega stores are pretty much done. I mean, you've got Flipkart, you've got a few other guys, and everybody tried to go the mega store model. Now that works for a few people. Except probably Flipkart is going to win that round because they've raised more money than anyone else. They've got more market cap than anyone else. And they're a very well-respected company. They've done a lot of marketing and advertising. People trust them. Because of that, you're probably not going to beat them in a mega store model. But where you can beat a guy and make a niche for yourself is by getting into a niche that really very few people are into at this point of time. That's where really possibly the market is in the next few years. We've seen in the last few years what has happened in the US is that niches haven't really been the problem. There have been niches. They've been going into different things. People will launch only giving one specific service or product, and they've been doing well. Where the US has gone today is social shopping. In a big way, social shopping has come up in the United States. And the second thing is flash sales. Has everybody heard of onekingslane.com? Anybody? OneKingsLane.com? Okay, it's this US website that was started a few years back by these two women, one from San Francisco, one from New York. And they basically started flash sales of home decor items. So it is, I think, the second largest home decor website in the world for e-commerce. They've cleared over 100 million in sales last year. And they've been funded massively for the same reason. The entire point is that when they went into, and most of the products they sell are not branded by any big brand. They are branded by One Kings Lane. 75% of the products they sell are One Kings Lane products. But the reason they've done so well is flash sales. Because they've kept customer interaction very high, that if you come back every day at 11 a.m., we're going to launch a new flash sale. So come have a look, you'll get a great deal which you're not going to get otherwise. So that is where really they've made a huge niche for themselves, and it's a very well-respected website. In India, what has happened is, again, there are very many niches which have not been explored in India, because India is obviously many years behind the US in this stage. But again, the niches are probably the next place where it's going to go, not mega stores anymore. And apparel, etc., they're not really big niches anymore unless you can make a big work on how you sell apparel or electronics. The point is, you really, there isn't a lot you can do with selling electronics, for example. Maybe there are a few niches you can explore, but again, the market is not huge for this. So anyway, that's my personal viewpoint. A few other things I wanted to talk about. Okay, so I made a list of categories where basically e-commerce or offline retail survives. So wanted to discuss with you guys, has anybody been effectively able to replace these offline services which already exist today? So the first would be restaurants. I mean, there's no real way to go online. This has not happened in the US, it's not happened in India, it's not likely to happen. It's not an easy solution anyway. Nobody has done that to date. But again, some very interesting startups are in the US which are trying to solve this problem. Restaurants and let's say eating outside, etc., that involved with online transactions or with online shopping or with deals, etc., that has already gone in a very big way. That succeeds in a very nice way. A few very interesting startups, what they are doing in the US is, anybody can basically cook at home. You can book a table at their home, you can go and have food, basically. So let's say it's this Greek woman who can make some real specialties and she's really good at that. You can book it, and by the way, you can check user reviews, you can check photos of food, you can check whatever you like. You accordingly book, you go, you have it. Go sit with your friend or something, go to the table and have a good time. And it's reasonably cheap as well. So again, that is a model which sounds very good in theory. In practice, nobody has been able to make it work in the US so far. But anyway, it's a nice theory and actually people are trying that at least. The second would be apartments. So something like Craigslist in the US is very successful. It's done really well for itself, apartment hunting, etc. In India, not so many, but yeah, Sulekha, etc., classified websites do exist and they're not doing a very bad job at it. There is some refinement, there's a lot of refinement to be brought in the process, because in India, obviously, we've got a lot of other issues, too many middlemen, brokers, etc., who really control the market. Online is something which a very few people end up doing. But again, it's starting to become successful as the reach of internet spreads, obviously, this would be solved. Third would be books. I think we don't need to talk about that. That's pretty much solved. Fourth would be cars. So in cars, let's say, I mean, not new cars, obviously, let's say second-hand car. The guys who really control the market are the guys who are getting the large inflow of used cars that they can sell off. So which are the guys in all the auto markets in Bangalore or any city, which, you know, they have a row of cars standing there. You come, you have a look, you negotiate, you buy whatever you'd like. And that's great. Except a lot of this has moved online in other countries in the West. So how this has happened is, for example, eBay cars is huge. You go to eBay, you buy a car, and you refuse delivery if it does not meet the exact specifications shown by the seller. So that actually has made a lot of sense, and it has significantly changed how secondhand cars are being sold in the US. eBay cars is just one option, there are many other websites for that. But again, it has taken the model online. The next would be groceries. Okay, so in groceries in India, a lot of people have tried, because it is one sector where nobody has really commanded market dominance. Nobody has done something significant in that sector. So a lot of grocery guys who started out a few years back have gone bankrupt. But what they're trying now is more localized grocery selling. So for example, there are at least four startups to my knowledge who are only dealing in Gurgaon groceries. If you want something in Gurgaon, you live there, please book with us, we'll come and we'll deliver at your home within the next few hours or one day. So that is one thing, but very interesting, but again, no one has been able to crack the market. Clothing, again, clothing has a lot of touch and feel concept here. Everyone really wants to see what they buy before they buy it. So that is one really big thing. So Myntra, etc. have done really well on this. But again, there is some significant work to be done. And the touch and feel concept, again, from the US as well, it has not gone. It is, today, 95% of sales, retail sales in the United States are brick and mortar stores. Only 5% is actually e-commerce. Although e-commerce is potentially a huge market, it is not that big today. Today, it's about a $225 billion market in the United States. That's a very impressive number, but normal retail outshines it to about 2 or 3 trillion. So it is not that significant there. Then you talk about things like, well, apparel, by the way, you're also talking about shoes, which again, a few websites are doing really well. But again, a huge touch and feel concept. Even in the US and Western countries, it has not significantly moved online, such that the brick and mortar stores have really been affected and gone out of business in a big way. And along with that, there are more specialized services such as lawyers, doctors, etc. Now that has actually seen some very interesting things in India. A lot of companies have come up giving legal services online, giving legal advice online, doctor's advice online, and they're actually doing reasonably well. Now, nothing would obviously replace sitting in front of a lawyer and talking to the guy, or sitting in front of a doctor and, you know, having him examine you, but it doesn't change the fact that it is an interesting thing and it is moving online, but we are obviously restricted by the normal factor that you want to be in front of that guy. So, okay, I had a lot more, but I really don't have the presentation here. So I just wanted to take questions. If you guys have anything, we can talk about it. Okay, so I've been interested in the e-commerce market for a very long time, for about the last 1 year. And because I was getting into the e-commerce market, we've launched our product about 21 odd days ago. We've had a pretty good response from the market. It's called Kamastra.com. So it is basically India's largest online store for, basically an adult-oriented store online. So it is pretty much India's largest there, and we're doing pretty well. 21 days, we've got a good response, so that's what I'm basically doing. Yeah.
So, see, the thing is, what happens when Amazon comes to India and all this? Because I know Amazon is such a good thing, but once he comes there,
okay,
on spot days, not for a...
Fair enough.
What will happen?
Okay, so okay, I'll give you one example first, and then I'll get to India specific, which is Walmart versus Amazon today in the US. Okay, Walmart in normal retail is pretty much the king of normal retail. Nobody is even close to his size. He's beaten all his competition in the United States. And Walmart was looked at, okay, he's untouchable. That even if Amazon, etc. come, this guy's business is safe. And Walmart never did significant efforts to go online. Their online system was really bad. They had bad algorithms. Recently, they bought a lot of firms. In the last few years, they bought a bunch of firms that had great search algorithms, better way to sort data, keep data, make sure that more conversions are happening on their website, etc. So they are significantly ramping up because they've realized the threat is from Amazon right now to them. Because now a bunch of retailers in the US, okay, including Walmart, are having basically Amazon prices every day. Meaning whatever price you're getting on Amazon, you walk into my store, I will give you the same price. Now, it is not really easily affordable for them, but it makes sense because they really need to keep the consumers. Amazon has changed things too much in the US. So, India specific, again, I can't tell you what's going to happen in the future. Obviously, my own prediction on this is, today in the FDI and retail market, e-commerce is not allowed. Okay, e-commerce is not being opened up, and that is going to save the guys who are right now in the e-commerce market. Flipkart is the biggest guy, obviously. These guys are going to be saved for the next few years if this thing is there. If e-commerce passes and Amazon does come into India, let's be frank, Flipkart is about a $1 billion enterprise, Amazon is a $100 billion enterprise. There's really no comparison. And Amazon would take a few years probably to get their feet right in India to build up the same logistics, warehousing facilities they've got in the US. But it wouldn't be surprising to me if they came and they hired all the top guys of Flipkart and probably got it done far cheaper and far faster.
Just a quick thought on that. I used to work for Walgreens.
Okay.
I mean,
to be frank, I don't think Flipkart is taking advantage of those either today, SEZs, etc. Because the SEZ thing is in India is actually facing severe difficulties. So I think if Amazon personally comes, I mean, if nothing else, they would outspend them 10 to 1 and probably get the same warehousing much faster, and they would get the best guys from Flipkart, who know the market, who know how to fix it.
Today I'll make 20, you have 4 kinds, I'll make 20, I'll be the market leader. or this circuit at 349, I'll put 325 and I'll take the marker. So that's a way. And every time your internet muffler at any point in time is shameless enough to say, who might have come with error or to bother.
No, it's I have not been around that.
No, I don't doubt that, but again, if you're buying online, you don't know the quality of one shirt versus another, so a lot of people would shift. I mean, he's right in a way that, yes, it has ultimately become a price game for a lot of people, price and range game. And the thing is that we've already got enough mega stores in India. One more coming up is really not going to change things significantly. And to get to the position where people are trusting you, especially with their credit card information, they're making payments, doing all that is hard. And it is too cluttered, you're absolutely right, which is why I believe personally that there's going to be a consolidation in the next few years. A lot of guys are definitely going to go out of the market. Absolutely. Okay, fair enough. So what challenges did I face as a startup in launching? Severe lack of knowledge, basically very high burn rate of cash, which was a real problem for me, because you've got to, and manpower is just too big a problem. Because to get the right people who know what they're doing, who can actually fix your problems and solve them, is extremely difficult in India. I mean, technical proficiency we do have, so that is not the biggest challenge. But other proficiencies, people who are very competent in what they're doing, procurement, logistics, supply chains, very hard to find the right people. Internet marketing, those are the real issues, yeah. We are the largest adult-oriented e-commerce site in the country, basically targeted towards your needs and wants in the bedroom. That's basically our mission. Absolutely massive. Okay, in US it's about $2 billion a year, right? In India, no one has done this. So, I mean, I would not be able to predict the market accurately. Yes, they are. I'm not doubting that. But again, that's a small part of the overall collection. The mega stores basically, and they have everything. It's a small part of their collection. So, I'm the probably, I think, one of two websites in India that is only focused towards that. And I'm giving more product ranges than these guys ever. That's where I believe my mission. That's personal, yeah. It's only actually that's personal and mine which is Kama Sarada. There's nobody else. Buy undercover, okay. There are some severe issues with that. One being they don't have a massive range. They're more for retail sales, so they've actually opened stores. A couple in Bombay, I think a couple somewhere else. So they're more focused in that. E-commerce is really not their game. E-commerce, they've just ventured into it that why not? You know, let's just do this as well. Let's set it on. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Look, payment gateways in India, a lot of them are really bad. Because they will promise you 1 week, we'll integrate with you, 2 weeks, we'll integrate with you, and they take 3 months. That has happened too many times. So, I mean, I took a lot of advice in the market, I find out. Sorry, I've taken EBS, it's really good. They also work with Flipkart, they work with a bunch of other guys, I've gone with them. They took a little longer than I expected, but they came through, so I'm pretty happy with it. So, and the rates were also fairly reasonable, so to speak. I didn't have a problem. CC Avenue is expensive. Very frankly, it's a little bit expensive in terms of rates for credit card, debit card, etc. They were charging me much more than EBS, which is why I got it. And EBS is just as reliable.
Can I invest?
Authorized?
Right.
Is it like PayPal? The problem is this, the same issue with PayPal. If you want to integrate it with your website here, if you pay via PayPal to someone else in India, right, the money actually goes to the US and then gets paid into their account. The problem is then all these laws have come into the picture that it's not allowed to do all this kind of money transfer, which is why you have to go with an Indian payment gateway. Otherwise, PayPal or Google Wallet or their integrations are the easiest by far. Yeah, it's great for them. It's absolutely great for them. But in India, we just don't have a system like that. What we've got is the best we've got is EBS, etc. Yeah. It's just not. All the guys who are abroad who are doing this really well, like PayPal and all who sorted it, they're not allowed into India, they've got too many issues, so it's not easy.
When you say it doesn't work, it's not good enough.
Yeah. You mean PayPal, etc.? Indian e-commerce.
Indian payment gateway.
Indian payment gateway. They're pretty good, but they're very inefficient in the back-end operations when talking to you. I mean, they will process payments, there won't be too many bounces, none of that kind of thing, fraud and all, that's not the bigger problem. The bigger problem for you is talking to them and getting your work done out of it, which I realize is a massive pain.
Which is, I think it's more
I mean, they will, the work will not happen on time. They'll take a little bit of time. They'll get some approval, something. Nahi sir, boss ko gaya hai. And you get stuck. The same Indian mentality comes into the picture there. It becomes a little bit of bureaucratic. So it's
not a system problem.
It's completely a company problem. It's not a system problem. The system's absolutely fine. There's no issue.
So
the other
interesting question, what about logistics?
Okay, logistics in e-commerce. Okay, so there are a bunch of companies giving logistics for e-commerce companies specifically or even for general companies. You can tie up with them. There are significant numbers of those in India who are doing reasonably well. People like Digital DC, etc. also started e-commerce businesses. E-commerce parts of what they do. You should definitely talk to them if you're looking to start an e-commerce company. They're reasonable. I mean, again, the people issue will not go away. That you have to ultimately talk. You've got to get a good rapport going with them. Otherwise, they're not going to give you the best service possible. But they do give you good rates. They do give you efficient delivery. So it's not the worst thing. Not your biggest problem anymore if you're a small company and you're just starting up. Because you can afford to pay 5 rupees more on the product.
So regarding these logistics, now
just one second, can I just finish? He's just asking, yeah. Absolutely. Look, if you are a company that tries to be a Flipkart tomorrow, right? That says, I need to save money everywhere and make as much money as possible, give better rates to my customers, etc. Then this kind of thing you can't afford. Then you need to look at much more efficient solutions or you need much better deals with these guys if you're going to outsource it or whatever. See, today for me as a company, right, my niche is completely different. I'm not concentrating on logistics as the way that I'm going to get my customers. Logistics is important, sure. I'm going to make sure the customer gets the packet. It's in good condition. There's no issue there. If it's cash on delivery, he gets a COD, the payment comes to me, it's fine. That's what I care about. But my niche is saying giving the best products, giving the range which is not there in India. So I'm not concentrating on that. I'm happy to pay 5 or 7 rupees more if I don't have to think about that problem today. If I grow in size, then the 5-7 rupees becomes important, then I need to find a better solution for myself. Today is not the most critical thing on that. Okay? Mine? I mean, see, it depends. Because right now, I'm just figuring it out. We're just into the market for a few weeks. We're figuring it out. So far, the margins are reasonable. It's definitely doable as a business. And no one is really doing this right here. Which is where the real niche is. Because, okay, for example, I'm getting a few products into India that have just never existed in India. Because I've formed about 15 national and international tie-ups with different brands abroad. So I've got these kind of tie-ups. I'm getting products which literally have never been seen in India. That is where my niche is. Sorry. Okay, edible lingerie. Does not exist. Lubes and oils, right? Today, the only lubes you could possibly go out and buy are Durex. That's literally the only guy out there. We've formed tie-ups with about 4 to 5 brands to bring lubes into India that really do not exist. And are meant for this usage. Okay, meant for the bedroom. That's it. And they're really good at what they do. They're very good international brands which are being sold on many other websites abroad.
So
yeah.
My question was regarding logistics and specifically. Now so many new e-commerce sites have come, like Shopkloos and Payless, and I see that they come up with these teams of, you know, soaps and toothpaste and
yeah.
items for $40 and they do, you know, shipping included. Mm-hmm. How do they make money out of this? Or is
they
it
don't.
Just to increase the user
base? It's probably to increase the user base. Actually at 40 rupees, very frankly, I doubt you can make any money. Because at the very lowest, okay, it's going to cost, let's say you're sitting in Bangalore, right? And your customer is sitting in Delhi and he's bought a toothbrush or something. At the very least, it's going to, even with the cheapest courier at the best deal because you're doing such a high volume with that guy, he's going to charge you 10 odd rupees for that product, at the very cheapest. So at that kind of range, I doubt you're making any money. If you make 1 rupee, it's a good deal for you. But it doesn't change the fact that it's a cheap way for them to enhance their customer base, they're moving products, so it's good. Because if they give a customer a good experience, he's more likely to come back and buy from them next time if he's satisfied with the purchase. That it was packed well, it came quickly. Let's say cash on delivery, the cash went on, no issues, the product was as expected. So then it's probably more on that. I doubt you can make money on a 40 rupee product, it's very hard. Almost impossible. Maybe a guy like Flipkart who's got such a large scale can do that. Nobody else can.
So,
yeah.
I have a different situation here. Like, I just passed on my experiment and I've been doing my electronic secret sales as a dealer in Bangalore.
Yep.
So, on the technology part, what can you suggest me? Like, I'm looking to launch an e-commerce.
Okay.
So, I found many open source e-commerce are there. So, which one you should suggest for me?
How big do you want your business to be? Like, I mean, are you trying a huge scale? Are you trying a small scale? What is your plan?
Presently, I'm looking only for the sales in time.
Okay, small scale. So, you're not looking at a very big thing. You just want efficient payment gateway processing,
cash
on delivery.
I just need COD.
Great. If you're doing that, then you don't need something very complicated. Go to PrestaShop. Okay. Use their systems. They've got a bunch of free templates online and paid templates. Paid templates you can buy for like starting from $50 going up to about $200. There are a lot of templates which are really good and meant for different uses. Pick one that suits you and buy it.
Yeah, and there's difference between these products, they are not available in the India. You don't have the rights to advertise these.
Yeah.
So how can I market them?
lawyer, very frankly. I can't tell you on this market. I don't know anything about this market. So I can't really tell you on this. Sit with a good lawyer and ask him how he's figured it out. Or what some other company is doing to advertise the same thing in India. I'm sure there are other companies. Have a look at what they're doing.
Maybe something like that. E-commerce site for electronics.
Okay, but is anyone selling
this? In most cases, what you have to do is, let's say, for instance, in India, there are quite a lot of things that are illegal on, not permitted on e-commerce, but illegal. Say, for instance, one of them is anything to do with tobacco, smoking, anything to do with drinking, no alcohol can be sold online. Lawyers cannot actually give this one online. That is prohibited. To an extent, your medical health also, if it is a specialist, this one is not allowed to go online. Unless there is a one-to-one interaction, there is no broadcast possible. So that's not this one. That's not allowed in this case. So in these cases, what do people do? People either take either of these two approaches. One is that they go stealth, which is they really it's really word of mouth, and it's really as I call it, an MLM without multi-level marketing, without multi-level marketing. So it's basically somebody, you tell five people, those five people say another five. So you incentivize more like an affiliate. So you tell somebody, hey, listen, if you suggest somebody, I'll give you a cut from whatever product is sold, and that's how you go about. That's one. The second bit is taking it only online. And taking it only, giving whatever is, if you sell a service, if you sell something, then is when you are basically violating the laws. If you don't sell it, let us say you're saying, I'm giving out something without, cost to you. So in terms of content, in terms of whatever that you can do, that is when you can start, converting people or to people who are interested, and then they will buy. So it's a longer scale cycle. In most cases, that's
sure.
How we
So classified, Sulekha, Lokanta, all these kind of things, OLX, etc. Right? Okay, they're pretty good, except the monetization strategies are pretty bad right now. They're really not making money because it's very hard. I mean, Sulekha, I think, is making some money. OLX, I'm pretty sure, is not. A few other guys, I don't think the other guys are also in India who are making money really. The problem is that, see, ultimately classifieds work if people are very interactive with that website. If people are really posting, they're replying, they're, talking about things, whatever, good services, whatever they want to talk about. That's the only time a classified website really works. So everyone is trying to reach that kind of scale where everybody's talking about things. Except it's not very easy to reach that scale and to get the kind of, have you seen Craigslist, for example, in the US? Have you seen the kind of interactions on that? It's amazing. The amount of people talking about things, giving good services, etc., talking about whatever, people will put up jobs online, part-time, freelance work, people will answer. You have got good people who are there. Ultimately, it only works on that. Can you get these guys there who are really responding, who have enough content to really be worthwhile? So it only comes down to that, basically. Today, they're making a fight. I think OLX is the best one in India so far. But I don't think they have any great monetization strategy so far. They've got like premium listings, premium ads, a few other things. That's about it, really. But I mean, they probably need a better monetization strategy than that. I mean, honestly, somebody needs to come up with a better monetization strategy on these kind of websites rather than do this. Maybe you want to provide your own featured services and products, on OLX, along with the other classified stuff, second-hand, whatever. Maybe you figure out some other kind of means which works, basically. The problem is today, if only you're running on premium ads, the dot-com bubble was only about that. People just advertising and hoping it would pay your way. It doesn't pay your way. It's not enough. And something like OLX, if you're getting the kind of customer interactions you want, if you've got, let's say, 2 million people who are interacting every day, who are talking, who are really there as a website, you need a lot of backend to support that. You need a lot of customer care, etc., to support all that kind of stuff. Where is that money coming from? It just cannot be by ads. You need to think of a better monetization strategy to make it work, basically. Maybe, you become like a pawn shop and say, the second-hand stuff, I'll buy it, I'll verify the quality and then sell it for a bit of money or something. I mean, maybe that's a way to go, maybe something. But it needs a better monetization strategy than what's on today. Premium ads really don't cut it on that scale. Okay, a lot of time. A lot more than I care to admit, frankly. Because, see, a few problems were, I was trying to launch this thing in India, which is brand new and really no one does this. So firstly, the first step I took was I went to a lot of lawyers. I figured out exactly what was legal, what was not. That was the first issue. I solved that reasonably easy. That wasn't the biggest problem. I met with 7 lawyers. I solved that problem. Okay, I came to know what's legal and what's not. After that, to make the supply chains, to find the right guys abroad, to make the tie-ups, to make the partnerships that they can get. I went with a website developer. That guy just screwed me over halfway and gave up. And that he wasted 2 months of my time. I couldn't do anything about it. But I wasted 2 months, frankly. And everything else was ready on the side. I was waiting for that, and that guy did that. So, okay, I found another guy, he developed the website from scratch, and yeah, it happens. What can I do? I've actually been working. I wanted to launch, very frankly, in about end of November or early December. I've launched in early Feb because of all these random reasons, and there's really nothing much you can do about it. So, okay, I got a little more time, I made a few more tabs, I talked to a few more people, so I used it well. That's all I could do.
So, I'm sure the website, the building of the website was the last setting.
Yeah, for me it was.
You had
yes.
to do the background checks and all the other things before.
Yes.
Went on to develop the website.
Yes, absolutely. See, for my thing, it was more about launching products which really don't exist in the Indian market. So the first like 2-3 months, 2 months odd, I was Googling, I found out everything being done everywhere across the world, what is worthwhile, what's not worthwhile, what makes sense in India, what doesn't, what people will respond to, do they need to be educated on these concepts? Because again, if it's something about the bedroom, a lot of Indians are really naive about it. They don't know a lot about it. You've got to tell them, okay, this product is for this reason, this is why you buy one, this is of this quality you should buy that one, etc. To tell them all that is not the easiest thing. So we're building significant educational content to solve that problem as well. So that was how we went about it. The website, unfortunately, became my last step, although I wanted it to come much earlier.
Does it also educate people who are lying, as you're saying?
Yeah. Today it doesn't, but we're launching significant educational content to solve that problem. Because again, most of these products have never been seen before in India. So maybe some people will understand, some people who are, okay, reasonably westernized, if, you know, you read a lot of books, watch a lot of TV, you get that. But a lot of people just won't. To explain that concept is much harder. Selling books or electronics is far easier.
What prompted you to bring this in? I mean, there is already a dying market, there is already a resistance.
Yeah.
So what prompted you to bring it in?
Okay, I wanted to get into e-commerce. So that was my first stepping stone. I said, why not do something in tech, maybe e-commerce? And e-commerce was booming. I said, yeah, why not? I'll look into it. And I researched it. I went through all the websites abroad that were really good, that stood out and said, yeah, this is really good. This is a nice business model. And these companies seem to be doing extremely well. And I realized that the entire bedroom market was completely neglected in India, no one does it. And I mean, like it or not, it's not like the demand doesn't exist in India. Let's be frank, it does. People definitely want these products. I mean, we don't have the fastest growing population in the world for nothing. So, people want the products, but you don't know how to go about them, or if you can buy them, or how you can buy them. So I'm trying to remove the embarrassment from that buying process. If you buy something from me, I've got a concept which is pretty much trademarked and copyrighted by me called the black box. It comes in a plain black box, with no distinguishing mark of any kind. It's wrapped in white plastic with the invoice on top. The invoice is not in the name of kamaster.com, it's the name of my company, which is something else entirely, which is ambiguous. The product names are not mentioned, nothing is mentioned on the invoice. It is impossible for someone to know what you have received. So if your watchman gets it, yeah, you're not embarrassed. Your credit card bill will not reflect the real company, will not reflect kamaster.com, it will reflect my company name, which is Andural Retail Private Limited. Basically, I've chosen the name because it means nothing. So nobody's embarrassed. Yeah, that's point two. But look, I'm trying to remove the embarrassment from the buying process here. Because even if, let's say I gave everybody the option and I opened a complete web, I mean, have you guys heard of masalatoys.com? Anybody? Okay, or sexytoy.in. Okay, these guys sell sex toys in India. It's completely illegal. You cannot do it. Now, they have online portals which have these products. Now, what very reasonably should cost about, let's say $500 in the West, right, would cost $5,000 here. And if you pay the money, you have no guarantee it's going to come to you. You have literally no guarantee. There are testimonials on the website saying, I paid $5,000, I never got this product. I mean, come on, that's unacceptable. After Flipkart, after these companies, it's really unacceptable to have this going. So I'm trying to bring the Flipkart-like quality in this in a completely embarrassment-free way. So we're tying up with a logistics company to make it even more embarrassment-free. We're probably launching a service which will make sure that nobody will ever receive the product except you. It will only come to you, no one else. So that's happening in the next few months to solve these issues. Anything else? Okay, so section 292 of the Indian Penal Code, which is basically banning obscenity in India, etc. It's complete crap. Because it is so ambiguous that law, anything could fall under it. It says anything that...
Brick and mortar shops have heard some
cases... Okay, on brick and mortar shops, if you go to Palika Bazaar or you go to Crawford Market, you would get any sex toy you want in the world. Okay, but you've got to know the guy, you've got to tell him, sir, thoda, kar do, he'll give it to you. No issues. But again, it works, that's fine. But it doesn't change the fact that when you buy a product from there, I mean, okay, I think a lot of people are going to be embarrassed to go to a shop like that and buy the products in the first place. And second, you're going to end up paying a lot more than the product is valuable. Now, for sex toys, that's probably the best option because I'm not going to sell them. It's completely illegal. The law here is section 292 of the Indian Penal Code, which basically says anything that appeals to prurient interests is disavowed, etc. And that's completely ridiculous as a law. I mean, anything could appeal to prurient interests. It does not clarify in any way, it does not specify in any way what the real problem is. So what I've actually done is I sat with a bunch of lawyers, I found out what products can be sold in India without too many legal issues, which is why I came up with my model. I've today got about four major categories. I'm launching another about three, hopefully in the next 3 months. And the categories which really do not exist in India except by me. So I'm doing this, but everything is completely legal. Literally no one can come after any of my customers ever. There are precedents. Absolutely there are precedents. Let's say sex toys, right, for example. Yeah. It's completely fine.
But
these lawyers have actually got very detailed research done on section 292, all past precedents of the law being actually used against any person for any reason, etc. And then they have detailed out and given me a list saying, yeah, you know what, you're okay on these, you're not okay on these. So what I'm not okay on, I'm not touching. So far, I'm not touching that. In fact, many guys like that person are doing a couple of things which are very close to the illegal point of view. Like for example, handcuffs, etc. It's actually, it's very crazy, but it falls under the Weapons Act in India. Plastic handcuffs. It's insane. It's absolutely insane, but what can you do about it? It's actually a legal problem. You can't really sell those without a problem. So I made sure I'm not selling those items, at least not today, until I'm very clear about the law. Then. So, yeah, anything else?
What do you mean by marketing?
Okay, so word of mouth is going to be big for me. I am trying a significant amount of, let's say, guerrilla marketing tactics to make my name out in the market. We are building significant content online. Because again, it's partly education here, but it's also good for me because I'm getting SEO as well, so that's nice for me. I'm building a lot of educational material online that if you guys want to read about something, if you're figuring out, if you want to buy something, I mean, if you want to go out and buy for your wife, for example, there's a good chance you don't know how to buy for her. You've got no clue how to buy lingerie for her. And that's fine, so I'm going to tell you how. I'm going to tell you what the aspects are you should look at, what material, etc. How accordingly you should choose something that makes sense for you. Word of mouth is a starting strategy for me. No, word of mouth is a starting. I don't have Facebook, Twitter like buttons on my website. Because even by mistake, if you click them, you'll be embarrassed. So let's not do that, right? What I am looking at is word of mouth is an easy way today for me as a startup, so it makes more sense. Later on, I'm starting severe internet marketing tactics. A few other things which we are getting into are the content building is massive. I've got a few other things which I really don't want to discuss at this forum, but a few other things which are really big which are happening, which I'm hoping would get literally lakhs of people interacting with my website on a daily basis. That's my strategy for the next 3 odd months, which is where I'm trying to go. And I think the content is something that people would want to talk about if given an anonymous forum to talk about it. If given a way that the privacy is preserved, why wouldn't you talk about it? There's nothing wrong with it. Ask questions, get your doubts solved, do whatever you want. Post your story or what you did, that's fine. But do that anonymously, absolutely. I'm going to guarantee your anonymity because I don't reveal data, I don't sell data, none of that. It's just not my business model, I don't like that. Yeah.
Are they imported
items? Sorry? Many are made in India, many are got from abroad. So I've got tie-ups with people in China, the US, Germany and Australia as well. So they are also giving me a significant number of items. I'm getting items from India as well. There is actually a lot of manufacturing of these products in India.
So manufacturing
is legal. See, technically, sex toys are being manufactured in India. Technically, alright? And they're being exported from here. But they're not being sold here. So because it's you do underhanded work, it sort of works out. You know, no one knows what you're doing, you might as well get away with it. But again, it's Indian law really, it's got too many problems there.
So how do you classify this kind of fake or something like that? Because I find a lot of
fake in what way?
The thing is, a lot of scams are happening, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of scams.
Mm. So you mean online for online buying?
Yeah, that's okay. And that too, respect to spend your talking about 6 months about
right.
I think a lot of scam products would be
there. Absolutely.
So how do you
handle
that?
Okay, on my website, right, what I'm trying to do, firstly, I have COD options. So if you're not sure, you can buy COD and that's fine. I'm going with EBS because it's a great payment gateway that goes with Flipkart. So you're sure that I'm not going to, you know, take your credit card details and it won't be a fraud issue.
I'm not talking about the technology.
Okay.
I'm talking about the product.
Few things. Okay. Firstly, I'm not selling sex toys, so let's not talk about that. Let's say lingerie, right? And I buy something and I sell it to you. You're wondering how do I confirm that it's? I have a very strict quality check mechanism. I make sure of every item going out. It's not torn. There's nothing really wrong with the item, and I have an exchange policy. The exchange policy obviously makes sure that someone is not using the item and sending it back to me. That I've taken care of. I have quality checks on that. And I have a patent system to actually deal with that. But again, on my side, I'm making sure that what I'm sending to you is not bad. If it is bad, you have an exchange policy. Send it back to me. I'll replace it. Or I'll give you a credit code. Whatever you like. I'm going to be with Flipkart standards, basically, in this market. That is where I believe my niche is. I'm not going to offer substandard quality of service. So, I know, I mean, ultimately it's very difficult to convince people that, you know what, I'm very legitimate, don't worry about it, you buy from me, you won't have to think about it. But ultimately, please do, try it once. If you're disappointed, seriously, I'll return your money. No issues.
So, as you're talking about niche, I'd like to know, what are the niches that work really well in the market?
Okay, so, many niches have been completely unexplored in India so far. They have really not been touched, and there's so much work that's possible. Look, I mean, let's say for online restaurants and ordering. Today, there is so much clutter in the market by all these random guys who say, you order for any restaurant, I've got all the hookups. You order through me, the menus are there, you buy, etc. Again, there's no clear market dominating factor. Nobody has really come up in that. The niches are harder and harder to spot these days. You've got to have something with a really different twist, and that twist needs to be enough for people to keep coming back to your website, and that's really bad. To be frank, I mean, if you really think of a niche which is, I mean, have you guys heard of Ixigo? Like, reasonably familiar with it? That's an old website, it's 2007, but I know the guy who runs that. So, what they basically did, it's like Kayak, right? Now, they are funded, etc., they've really made it. But the thing is that it just basically aggregates from other travel websites and gives you the best travel deal possible. It shows you in a graph saying, okay, you know what, the rates are going to go up for the next 2 days and then going to drop, then this and this. It is that easy. Now, it's a smaller niche, really. Okay, it's not the same niche as ClearTrip has or MakeMyTrip has. But it doesn't change the fact that it is a really valuable service in the market. See, finding the niche is always going to be your problem. You've got to find something which really appeals to customers and keeps them coming back. But you've got to find something that works. Now, I know this guy in Bombay who's running this firm. This woman who's running a firm. What she basically does is, she gives you salon services at home. So she's got a basically one huge room of all the beauticians, etc. sitting. You order something, she comes to your home. She gives you the entire salon treatment, the same thing you'd get there, but in the comfort of your home, so that's great. Her infrastructure cost is low since she's not maintaining a salon or spa. And she gives you a better cost for that. Now she's only doing it in Bombay today. Okay, she's actually been funded already, and now she's looking to expand to other cities. Okay, I'm not saying it's insanely scalable, but maybe you come out with your own range of spa products in a while or whatever, and you start pushing that as well. Maybe even manufacturing. But there are ways you can go up. It's not completely as a closed model. I mean, there are many of those new social apps that have come out in the US, right? All the new social websites will give you one more little bit of thing that, you know, now you can do this. You can check in with your friends here, or you can do that. Those are really not scalable. In my opinion, I personally think the social thing is a massive problem. Because I don't think it's really scalable beyond a point, and everybody is offering just minimal incremental social functionality on the other guy. So it's not really insanely scalable to keep doing that, you know. You need a different business model and way of looking at things which really redefines the problem. That's the only way that it really makes sense as a startup. If you want to grow, I mean, to that scale.
I think there was one more thing that was there.
Right. Yeah, so, okay, there was this one person, I've seen the same video, the guy in the US, right?
Yes.
Okay, what they do is they make ice cream in front of you, using liquid nitrogen, which is really quick freezing, right? They'll take it, they'll just spray it on that, and basically they will get ice cream in front of you in the next 10 seconds. And it's creamier and better, because the amount of cream in your ice cream increases the faster you freeze it. So considering you're doing this quickly, it's more creamier, it's a better taste. Now this guy in the US is actually doing reasonably well because they've started a bunch of stores which are doing this. And I mean, ice cream is a very touch and feel thing, nothing really online in this. They did this, they're actually doing reasonably well. Now, whether they'll be able to scale up is a problem, but they solved all the US health requirements, etc., and they were very happy with it. The US agreed to everything and said it's cool. So I'm assuming the process is not harmful in any way. You can't really, you know, screw it up, even though you've got a liquid nitrogen tank next to you. So anyway, that is an interesting idea, it definitely makes sense.
License, she can license that particular aspect. Yeah. Not really franchise, licensing also in terms of, you can use my patented procedures, but you not use my license.
Alright, any other questions on starting up or something? I can definitely help you guys out.
So FBI or retail, you said that it's already not coming. I have also read something that Flipkart is also flouting many of retail norms by using.
Apparently, all the funding that's coming to them is coming from abroad. Exactly. It's actually beating FBI and retail norms. But apparently, no one has caught up. So, I mean, it's good for them, right? And once you reach that kind of size and scale, it's harder for someone to catch on you. And it's Indian law, it's not the most efficient in the world, so. Market validation, you mean for Flipkart or? Okay, yeah. So, like, I mean, what kind of feedback am I getting? What is the deal on that? Okay, so I've received a few feedback. The people have spread it to in the first 20 odd days. I've been largely friends, family, some technology forums, some entrepreneurship forums where, you know, I've been a part of for a long time. I've been contributing for a long time. So these are the initial people I went out to. So I got some really good feedback. I found kinks with my website that I hadn't realized. I fixed them. I mean, small functional issues, etc. So I solved all those kind of problems. That was a good part. On the product front, I've given a few products. I've sent sample products out before to friends, etc. Just to get an idea because I wanted to test my logistics. I wanted to test the product quality. I wanted to test all that. And I'm getting really good feedback on it. Because people are really happy because my prices are really good. I'll be frank, my prices are really good. Okay, you would get the same thing at That's Personal for 2 grand. You'll probably get it in mine for about a grand. So I'm actually competing on price on that level with the guy. Product quality is pretty good. I mean, you're not going to wear it too many times, let's be frank. You're probably going to use it a few times, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, and you're probably going to get bored and buy something else. So accordingly, you're not looking for the best made product. You're not looking for German engineering kind of quality, right? China will do. So let's be frank there. So accordingly, look, what I'm looking for is something that gives a great experience to the user for a reasonable cost, which they have a good time with, and they, you know, they're happy to leave. They're okay, great, worth it. On the website?
Yeah, what kind of stuff?
Products. Okay, so 4 major categories we started out with is, one is entirely basically bedroom related lingerie, which is by far our largest category. Second is fantasy and role play costumes, which is again a huge category. Third is a massage and bath product, which is entirely about, you know, giving your partner sensual massage or going for a bath together, that kind of thing. Everything to make that happen for you, basically. Be it from ambience, you know, candles, potpourri, all of that kind of thing, to the real creams, oils, lotions, whatever. And the fourth is called naked wear, which is basically body jewelry, etc., which goes directly on your body, no clothes involved. So those are 4 categories. We're launching about 2 more, hopefully by the middle of April or the end of April at the latest. So we're already in talks, we've already made the tie-up, so we should be going ahead with that by the end of April.
What's the URL?
Kamastra.com, KAAMASTRA.com. So, by the way, please have a look and seriously buy something. You won't be disappointed, I promise you that. If you are, your money back, no issues. Yeah. We are out about 20 days, so I mean, profitability is not the major concern right now. Right now, I'm just spreading my name in the market as much as possible. That's not the biggest concern for me. But again, I'm hoping to be profitable in the next few months because I'm running with very low operating costs. So in the next few months, I'm hoping to be profitable and start turning up money. No, not yet. Yeah. Yeah, sure.
Continue your discussion.